He's Jim Nance, the lead play-by-play voice who joins us here on set. You don't live too far from here, do you, Jim?
A couple hundred yards.
Come on.
Yeah.
Really?
I'm not kidding. Yeah.
So you could have walked over.
I do almost, three times a week, right where you are. You're on the sacred sod of our practice facility, and there's no place that it gives me greater pleasure than being right here, a little quiet time and hitting a few rocks. But I just found out something. You were here for a milestone birthday.
Yeah.
No phone call. I mean, come on. What's up with that?
But
how did you not call me?
I didn't think you played golf anymore.
I play every once in a while.
But
do you have to play? I mean, what's wrong with a cup of coffee, a glass of wine, a hello, a handshake?
Hello, friend.
I would have gone out of my way just to say hello, friends, and happy birthday.
When did you come up with that hello, friends?
2002 PGA Championship at Hazeltine. I said it on Saturday's third round. My father was deep in the throes of his battle that he would lose in 08 to Alzheimer's. And he had faint recognition of his son. And I told him the last thing I had said earlier in the week when I went to see him in Houston was, I'm going to say a little cryptic message to you on the air this weekend, and it's hello, friends. I mean, because my dad had nothing but friends in his life. And I said it that Saturday when we came on the air. Now, Eli Spielman, a great friend of mine who co-authored a book that I wrote, it's been now 10 years, Always by My Side, a book about my father. He heard that on the air that day, and after the show, he called and said, I heard you say hello, friends. Where'd you come up with that? I told him it was about my dad. He said, you know what? That sounds like you. You ought to go up with that tomorrow. I mean, I think this is something you should do all the time. So I did it Sunday, and I have done it every show since. And I love it because for that little moment, I connect with my dad, and I feel like I'm talking to him. You know, there's a whole invisible audience out there that's tens of thousands and millions strong. And Jim McKay one time told me, when you look into that lens, think of one person. And he told me that when I was just out of college, long before I worked at CBS. And I never could quite relate to that. But when Hello Friends came along, it clicked, and it became something now that it's a calming effect. Every time I come on the air, I say Hello Friends because my dad had nothing but friends. And I think of my dad, and I channel him, and off and running we go.
The different cadence in your voice or the different tone of your voice when you go from basketball where you call Villanova's last second shot and then you're all of a sudden calling Augusta, that is there any kind of emotional roller coaster of I'm here with basketball, I can get there with golf, I'm just not there in my tone?
It's all organic. There's nothing that's synthetic about it. You have... take your situation here, Villanova, this past year in the championship game. You know, it would be very unnatural for me to call that like it's a birdie putt at the 18th hole. You know, I'm inside
can
of
you,
a
can you try that?
75. I don't know that
me,
I could.
Give me,
I don't know what it's
like. Jenkins.
Jenkins for the winner. Ooh, Villanova takes the title. Sounds a little strange.
Yeah, creepy.
But you know, it's I get asked that question a lot. And it really what it gets back to is that people don't understand the golf cadence and the levels of your voice and the modulation of it during a golf telecast. It's all the arena you're in. When you're in a 75,000 seat arena like we were down in Houston, and here they come down for the championship. I mean, that's what felt right. And when you're a few days later, you're at Augusta and you're as close to the flagstick, as Paul is down here on the end. You know, they can be that close.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be talking like, Chris Jenkins for birdie! And that would be unnatural. You know, you drop it down because you're out of respect. It's just one of the things, one of the tenets of the sport is you try not to distract the player unless it's the 16th hole at Phoenix.
Now, what do you think of that? What do you think of the setting at Phoenix?
Love it. In fact, yesterday we had a meeting with the PGA Tour, and just we do this every year, and I said, boy, it'd sure be nice if we could take the template for what they do. This event had 600 and some odd thousand last week, 205,000 on Saturday alone. It's a community event run by this group called the Thunderbirds, and they raise $10 million for the community through charity. So it's a social event. Why can't we drop that template, build like a stadium hole, with some other sites? There's that energy there that I think would be great for golf at more than just one location.
But what are the, because players won't play the event.
You know, I heard my partner Faldo say that on the air last week. Now, I don't know whether that was because they were staying away from that scene.
Yeah.
Or just the fact the way that normally people work a schedule. You don't get every player every week unless it's a major championship. But who did we have in the field last week? I mean, it was a blockbuster field.
Yeah.
You know, Jordan Spieth was there. Phil Mickelson was there. It was a great field last week. Hideki Matsuyama is one of the top 10 players in the world. And there were others. I just can't rattle them off right now. But it was a quality field. So to say, well, Jason Day wasn't there, is probably because he was staying. No, I don't buy that. You know, he's playing this week, and he's probably going to play maybe three of the next four, and he was just calibrating his schedule to work out like the normal flow that players do build a schedule.
Did you hear the Tiger news that he talked about he's going to pull out of the next couple of events? We just had that about 10 minutes ago.
Okay.
Yeah, Paulie got that. So
I rolled out of bed about 10 minutes ago, okay. So I missed that.
Yeah.
And,
so he's
definitely out of Los Angeles next week.
Yeah.
Thanks for ruining my day.
Yeah, sorry. Sorry.
That's too bad. I'm sorry to hear it. I really half expected it after what happened in Dubai last week. And he built this very aggressive schedule at the start of the year to play four times in 5 weeks, including the trip halfway around the world to Dubai. And then he was going to play California, L.A. next week, right back to Florida the next. I didn't see how it could possibly happen.
But why? And I don't understand this. I understand the Dubai, you get a paycheck there.
I don't understand that.
But why are you, it's not about a paycheck.
That's what I meant by
right?
What I just said. At this point, and now he's been a longtime participant, you know, on and off, but he's played that tournament for years. And yes, he's getting paid to go over there. But right now, whatever he's being paid is not going to change his life.
No.
What's going to change his life is he suddenly, you know, is competitive again and he's in contention. So, I'm not trying to question his schedule. Maybe he's got friends over there and he felt an obligation and a loyalty to go back to Dubai again. Maybe it was way beyond an appearance fee. But right now I would be building a schedule around what gives me the best chance to be Tiger Woods again.
And I'm to the point now, I just want to see him play and make the cut. Give me four competitive rounds that he feels like he's competing with everybody else. He'll never be able to compete with Tiger Woods. He's almost become Eldrick Woods. He needs to reinvent himself and be Eldrick instead of Tiger, because he can't compete with that. And it felt like that when he's playing with Jason Day and Dustin Johnson. They're blowing the ball 50 yards by him. And I think in his mind, he's still, can I be Tiger? And he can't be.
Well, it's hard for people that don't follow golf to understand why that happens, but he just doesn't have the speed in his swing that he used to have. Speed generates power. And when he was in his prime, it was an awesome sight to watch.
Well, you even referred to that. I think that he's probably about 10 miles an hour
slower
than he used to be.
Than he used to be.
Yeah.
That's a big deal.
Yeah.
I mean, that you can't play anywhere close to the level you used to play when you lose 8 to 10 miles an hour in your golf swing, your ball speed, club head speed. Look, the guy's been through far too many surgeries, and we all are waiting for the comeback. I hold on to one thing that gives you hope. When he was in warm weather and he was playing in the Bahamas in December,
yeah,
the swing looked
his
a lot
event.
Better than it did
yeah.
when he came to Torrey Pines and when he played at Dubai. There was a free flow to his golf swing that we know is attainable. Now, is it weather-related? Is it did something happened between December and the end of January where he got stiff again? In his lower back, I don't know, but I'm not giving up on him. He's 41 years old. In this sport, that's not the end of the road. It's not over until he says it is. And you can play. Look at what Phil's doing. I mean, Mickelson's a handful of years older than Tiger is, and he's never had those kind of injuries. He's stayed loose. His swing, he's gone through with his trainer, Sean Cochran. He's kept himself in the kind of shape where he's been able to avoid serious injury.
Can you stay for a second?
I would love to.
Okay, great. Okay. We'll come back with Jim Nantz, a few things to talk to Jim about. Anything else needs to be mentioned here, Paulie?
We have a business idea to pitch to Mr. Nantz after the break.
Good.
He's going to.
That's what I need.
He's going to rake it in. You're going to rake it in, Jim. Guaranteed.
Great. Yeah, now you're really going to want to stay. You can leave if you want after that.
No, it's not about that. It's like Tiger in Dubai.
It's not about the money.
It's about quality of life.
Of course it is.
That's why I'm here.
We can't promise that, but we'll get
you. That's why I live here. Okay. We'll listen.
We'll come back 16 after the hour. More with Jim Nantz after this in the Dan Patrick Show. When you play golf, Do your friends ask you to do play-by-play?
I usually do it without prompting. I can't help it. It takes a little pressure off because my game has sunk to pretty miserable levels, so I can kind of play act like I'm out here to announce it as opposed to anybody expecting my skill level to be any good. But what I do, it's just for the fun of it. You know, living here in Pebble Beach and living really close to the golf course, my family, we're big walkers. So, you know, if you live here, you got to get outside and enjoy it, even though, unfortunately, you've walked into, like, the worst weather we've had since we moved here 5 years ago. So I'm walking Pebble Beach to go down to work out at the beach club on a daily basis. And I'll walk either by 18 and 17, or there's another loop where I can go around 2, 3, and 4 and come right there and enter that way. And invariably, you come across a couple of groups. And, you know, sometimes, you know, they'll look over and they'll say hello. And then I'll just break into, you know, the golf commentator. Now, this for birdie, for the championship. But it's fun. It's all good fun.
Paulie, you have a business deal for Jim Nantz that's going to make him what?
Millions of dollars.
Millions of dollars.
So just now, looking for happiness.
Okay.
We pitched to Al Michaels the idea of Steak Night in America. All Al does is eat steak and go out with friends. And a TV show called Steak Night in America would be perfect for Al Michaels. For you, we have the Jim Nantz Sleep app. It helps you go to sleep. There is nothing more soothing than Jim Nance's voice. That's not even arguable. So we have it there. Jim will tape this, and you can put it on your phone. And when you're having trouble sleeping at night, you just play this over and over.
Okay.
Jim would need to read it.
Now, what happens when I can't sleep?
Whose app
am I using there?
We'll just play episodes of this show.
You said "Hey friend" instead of "Hello friend" in your copy.
Yes, because
"Hey
I,
friend."
Well, I didn't know if you trademarked it. I didn't know if I could even write it.
I didn't, but maybe I should have.
Okay, all right. So quiet on the set.
What level you want this? You want Chris Jenkins or you want Augusta?
I want Augusta. I want Amen Corner.
Hello friend, like, Jim Nantz here. It's nighty night time. Put on the jammies. Sip a warm glass of milk. Turn the phone off. Forget about the television. It's time for you to go to bed. A tradition unlike any other. A good night's rest. Now, I did kind of rework your copy a little bit. They're all out, Dan. They're all completely out.
You put them to bed.
How do you sell that? I mean, I'm in on the business proposal.
You voice it. We sell it as an app. All the people. Fritzy has trouble sleeping. Fritzy?
I do. That was getting me into that zone.
Fritzy,
I'll
do one thing. At this point in my life, I would do anything I can. I'm not trying to sell you anything here. To try to promote the cause of Alzheimer's research and awareness. If you ever came up, I know you're just tongue-in-cheek, but anything like that we could ever do, 100% of it would go to the Nantz National Alzheimer's Center down at Methodist Hospital in Houston. We got to find in our lifetime, Dan, you know, as we're both in a similar age bracket, these guys are just young kids, but we're going to defeat this thing in the next, I believe, the next 20 years, and there's going to be breakthrough research. I live it every day. We have this research center named after my father, who, again, passed away in 2008. We think it's right up there, if not the best, but with the handful of best Alzheimer's research facilities in the world. And we've had some people there because of confidentiality. I would never say it unless they had spoken out publicly about it. Peter Osterhaus, a former colleague of mine, has been treated there. Marty Schottenheimer's been treated at the Nantz Center down at Houston Methodist Hospital. And we wake up every day trying to think of different ways we can send out the message. And things are happening, and it's exciting. So business ideas, I'm not interested in. Ways of trying to change the world, and particularly for the people that have a loved one that's suffering, it's a miserable environment. Every day is torture for the caregivers out there in the world. And I think about them, and I grieve for them, and we're moving in on it.
What did you learn about your dad when he was going through this, or about yourself?
Well, it's easy to see your loved one lose their dignity. You know, we worry about, in our world, we're worried about, why isn't Tiger, you know, playing over here instead of going to Dubai? You know, these kind of things don't mean as much to me as they used to.
Yeah.
You know, like trying to figure out how my mother and my sister down in Houston are going to get through another day as my dad's at home and he can't get downstairs and he can't dress himself. And, you know, and then it gets even worse from there. You know, you learn the real hard realities of life. But I saw my father, you know, disappear a little bit more every day and fade from view. And I didn't want anyone to ever have to experience that again. Now, we have made inroads, but we haven't conquered it. Treatments are still in the, you know, phase two, phase three trial levels, but there's some really promising things going on. And I learned my dad was first stricken when he was 66 years old. He died when he was 79. He had a 13-year battle against it. You start thinking, 66?
Yeah.
Hey, that's close.
Around the corner.
Like, man, what am I going to do in that, for me, that 9-year period? Mm-hmm. You know, if I'm on the same track as my father, you know, let's do things that are going to make a difference. But I'm optimistic. I'm optimistic that the good things are happening. And that's why, after I wrote the book about my dad, I had so many people reaching out and saying, man, thank you. We had the same situation in my family. And I knew there had to be something more that I could do with my voice than just show up every week with the best seat in the house at these great sporting events. My voice is my father's voice, identical. My dad was never, ever on a show, interviewed on television in his life. He happened to give me his voice. So his voice is being heard through his son. And his son is trying to tell people, we are out here every day trying to find a way to do what my father would want me to do. And that is to make the most of your platform and help these people get the money and the research dollars that they can defeat Alzheimer's.
Jim Nance joining us. He's got the duties later today and also this weekend with CBS, the AT&T Pebble Beach Pro-Am. You've got guys who are stepping down. Bob Costas stepping down as the Olympic host. Brett Musburger stepping down. Vin Scully, Dick Enber. I mean,
Fern left the SEC this past.
Chris Berman has, you know, got a reduced schedule.
What is going on?
But I was mentioning this the other day, a couple of weeks ago. We're pretty lucky of what this generation has been all about. The last 30 or 40 years in sportscasting of who we've been around and the impact that they've had on people, right? I mean, Vin doing it at a high level at that age, Chris basically starting ESPN, Bob Costas, the face of NBC Sports in the Olympics. You know, there's another wave coming through, but that's a tough act to follow.
I don't know why all of this has happened in such a small time frame, and we have been lucky.
Yeah.
But the wave that was before us, the voices we were raised on, yeah, you could say Scully was a part of that. And maybe, you know, you could say Vern was a part of that. But I'm going back to the Jack Whitakers, the Jim McKays, Pat Summerall's, you know, Dick Enberg, who also just stepped away from the Padres,
yeah.
Legend, Chris Schenkel, Keith Jackson. You know, these were the voices of our youth, and they had a profound influence on me.
Keith Jackson.
Yeah. I wanted to be one of those voices. It had nothing with a desire of being on television.
Did you have one voice that you said, that when I hear that voice, that's
no,
me?
No, it was really a composite, okay, of a bunch of them. And, you know, the great thing is, and you did too, got to meet all of those,
yeah,
men that I just mentioned.
Yeah.
You know, and they were my friends. You know, Jim McKay, I delivered a eulogy at his funeral. And it was Paul Bearer. You know, I couldn't have imagined ever being, you know, when I was a little kid growing up, that I'd have these kind of friendships. Jack Whitaker is still alive and doing well.
A gentleman.
He's what a guy. And I have a dinner or two with him every single year. Now, he's just transitioned a little later this year than normally, but he lives in the summertime in Philadelphia, lives in the wintertime in Palm Springs. I mean, I love that man. And, you know, he's really from the generation of our way back when. He's one of the last guys around. He came here to Pebble Beach for our wedding and delivered one of the great toasts of all time. So,
are you allowed to repeat that toast?
Well, it actually just had to do with the fact that, you know, he was at Normandy. A lot of people don't realize that. Yeah.
I did not know.
Yeah. That. Yeah. He served our country and was right in the middle of,
wow,
of that incredible, you know, time and that profound event. And he just talked about the tactical operation and organization of that. He was there, and he was really paying tribute to Courtney, my wife. He says, not since then have I seen anything as well organized this wedding. So it was very sweet, and
That's great.
I said, I love the guy. I love all these guys. I really truly have them in my head circling around and thinking about what would Pat Summerall say here? What would Jim McKay, what would he want me to do? How would he have handled this? And I've really dedicated my career to trying to best represent them.
I'm glad you stopped by. Next time I'm in the neighborhood, I'm just stopping by your house, whether you're there or not.
You're welcome.
I'm going to hop the fence.
You're welcome to do that.
And I'm just going in, and I'm going to pour me a glass of the calling.
And I wish the Danettes and, you know, you come over and say hello. Well, how quick are you out of here today?
I'm staying till Sunday.
Well, we're going to get together.
These guys are leaving.
Why?
Maybe not.
See, we didn't get to talk about... You didn't allow me to do any scene sets here for the Monterey Peninsula. Here we are shrouded in fog on day two of the AT&T Pebble Beach Pro-Am. But this is truly one of the most glorious sights in the world. You know, it was Robert Louis Stevenson who said it was the most felicitous meeting of land and sea in the world. The Scottish poet. And this is Stevenson Drive, right here at the other end of the driving range. And there's just awe. Beauty and awe everywhere you look. I don't know if you can see it today or you have this week, but guys, McLovin, what do you think? Am I in the right place?
It's not bad. That's exactly how I described it to Dan yesterday, right?
You did.
Yeah.
You quoted.
You're out of town, though. You're just heading out.
Even in the same voice as Jim.
Yeah, we have to leave. But Dan, will you pay for us to change our flights to hang out with Jim now?
There you go.
No. I
got one more before you go. I know you're up against the break. Okay. Are you going to do the sound-alike contest again this year? Is that retired?
So. No. I love it every year, with your permission, of course.
Because I actually get a lot of feedback about that. I do. Oh, I get people to stop me.
But you didn't win.
I'm not saying every day, but a good once a month, I'll walk through an airport and someone will come over and ask me what I think about it, and then they'll just without asking, they will go right into it. I thought about calling in to Dan's show. What do you think?
Yeah.
And I'll say, that would win. You've got to do it. And on I go to my gate.
Yeah.
But you didn't win the Jim Nance sound
like
contest.
I lost one year I competed in. I know. What's up with that?
Hey, congrats on everything, your success, the wine that you have, the calling, which...
Well, how about the winner gets a this year for the satellite, gets a case of the calling?
Wow!
There you go.
Would you be in favor of that?
I would be in favor of that.
That's
absolutely
awesome.
So when we get to Masters Week, we'll that'll be the winning prize there. And did you try to go lower with your voice today, just a little, like to... Did you try to one-up me by going a little bit lower? You sent a message, did it? It was clear.
Me throughout the interview?
Yeah. 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 No, you did. You sent a message.
This is my morning voice here.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
I tried to go there.
No, you did. You did. Well done.
I've noticed a time or two.
Hello, friends.
Goodbye, friends.
Yeah, goodbye, friends.
So good to be here. Right. Thank you.
The Dan Patrick Show, weekday mornings on Audience.